Welcome to Stories on Stage Online Edition. I'm Monique Mulligan and today is our last online edition. I'm pleased to be chatting with Maya Linnell about her real romance, Bottlebrush Creek. This book was published by Allen and Unwin in June. Earlier this year, Maya was going to come over to Fremantle for the Romance Writers of Australia conference, but COVID-19 has put a stop to that. So instead, we decided to chat online. And we have scones. I've got some scones here, some jam and cream, and we may just enjoy them a little bit later. I've even got some tea sitting there, keeping nice and warm. So hopefully you've got a cup of tea as well and you're ready for a lovely chat with Maya. Maya, welcome to Stories on Stage.
Hi, Monique. Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you for joining me. It's really great to chat with you and find out how your book's doing. Fourth reprint is what I heard last.
Yes, I was very excited when the publisher announced that news. I was inquiring as to whether it had gone into any reprint, its second reprint, and just, the fourth one scheduled for this date. Whoa.
That's really, really good. So what's your secret?
Well, I don't know if I have a secret. I think it's just a really nice way for people to escape, especially in these times, with a good book.
Yeah, that's true. And I think that after reading Bottlebrush Creek, I think that's exactly what it is. It's that way of getting away, escaping to the country, to use that TV show and just seeing what life is like somewhere a little bit different since we all seem to be mostly stuck in our homes. So you launched Wildflower Ridge back, was that last year?
Yes, last winter.
So two books within a year.
Yeah, so they're spaced about 12 months apart. It seems to have flown around. It only feels like just the other day that I was trotting around the country doing a lovely book tour to talk about my first book.
Yeah, I remember, seeing, because your name was new to me at that time, and thinking, this Maya is getting a lot of attention and her book's just out, and I've written a manuscript that's called Wildflower. So, of course, yours caught my attention because it's, a very similar name. But now you're launching Bottlebrush Creek and you're right in the middle of COVID and lockdowns and things like that, especially in Victoria. What's been different this time around?
Yeah, Monique, there's been a few little factors that have been different. I think the fact that I can't actually physically get out and meet people and sign their books has been it's been a bit of a different one. I really enjoyed getting to do the library talks and going into bookshops and chatting with booksellers and readers and other writers as well is always such a treat. So that's probably been the biggest one, as well as trying to get the words down for book three while you've got kids at home was an extra little challenge. That I had to, I guess, get my head around. But it's been really good otherwise. I certainly can't complain. The book's been very well received by readers and it's really nice to see that even in these COVID times when we're all a bit worried about health and whether we're all going to go into lockdown again or just Melbourne City, it's absolutely fantastic to think about. That's a celebration.
Yeah, and I think it is, to me it's a celebration. I'm seeing lots of really good feedback about Bottlebrush Creek and I've really enjoyed reading it. It's a lovely, warm-hearted story. I enjoyed being taken to this sort of sea change kind of situation where the people are building a house and they're sort of in the country area but they're so close to the ocean. I have to say I feel a little bit jealous. just reading something there's always, what I love about rural romance is you have the laughs in there as well. You get to meet these really interesting characters and there's certainly plenty of those in your book. But before we talk about Bottlebrush Creek, I realised as I was sort of doing some background work for this interview is that you and I both have very similar backgrounds in that we're both journalists before this. And, I was, and you worked for I think, country papers, is that right?
Yes, that's right. I had a lovely time working for the Southeastern Times, which is a Millicent newspaper. It was twice a week when I was working there, but it's just gone back to one day a week.
Right. Well, mine was a once a week paper that I worked for in my local area. And you do certainly meet some really, really great characters there. So what I was actually thinking is, do these characters, did any of those people that you met over that time of being a journalist, have they made their way into your fiction?
Yeah, I think my characters are an amalgamation. So they're a little bit of people that I've met and just mannerisms of different people that I've spoken with or friends with or people even that I'm just sitting next to at the kids' sport training and stuff like that. So just take a little bit of people that you know and mix a heck of a lot of fiction and, you know, change their name, change their looks, but keep, you know, one particular aspect of someone that you know in each of the characters, I think. So it is nice to boil it all up and change it, but have a little bit of a reference if you're thinking, well, what would they say in that type of situation? Or, you know, how would they respond? It's nice to have a little bit of a reference point.
Yeah, I think so. I'm finding that I'll be in different places at the moment, and because I'm starting to write the next book in my series, obviously starting to think about material that I need for that. So I was in an op shop recently, and in the op shop, the people, there was a woman talking to her friend very loudly. It was a small place, so I couldn't not hear this conversation. And I didn't actually want to buy anything. I'd figured this out within about 30 seconds, but the conversation was too interesting for me to leave. So I just shuffled through the clothes, and they were talking about the granddaughter going to a festival and buying these shorts that were see-through shorts. And, you know, they're all the rage, darling. Everybody wears see-through shorts. I'm thinking, what? Who wears see-through shorts? And it was just this whole conversation about how so-and-so didn't like the see-through shorts, and this went on, and I thought it was hilarious. So I went home and I wrote it down. And then yesterday I was listening to somebody on the weekend about this whole conversation about breast milk and what it smelled like and tasted like, and it was just the funniest conversation to be. I was getting my hair washed, so again, captive audience to this conversation between hairdressers. And so I know that is somehow going to go into my book. Do you do that as well? You know, find yourself listening.
I do. I think you've got to have a good ear. And, you know, they don't necessarily stay with you, those conversations. And, you know, you certainly don't write every different detail down and say, oh, that was from the blogs at the supermarket on Thursday and whatnot. Yeah. But you do. Your mind kind of takes these little bits and plays with them and then rolls them around, I feel. That happens to me. And then out comes a conversation. And it mightn't be 6 months later that I'll be typing a scene. I'll be thinking, oh, now what will be that character's flaw? And one of the recent visitors that we had to our property was a chap. He was here. He's from an African country. And when my husband had said we're going to be processing a couple of cows, his ears pricked up and said, oh, I'd love to come. I'd take the hooves, I'll take the tail, I'll take the intestines. All the things that we kind of bury in a big hole in the back of the yard. But while he was working, he was such a vivacious chap, and he was doing these just little dances every now and then, just interjecting into a conversation with a little dance and talking about a few different things that I hadn't really thought of ever giving a character a couple of those mannerisms. But, you know, they stuck with me, and I won't be surprised if that kind of sticks into the next manuscript.
I think that's the thing about being a writer, isn't it? You do observe so much more, and sometimes I'll say to people, you know, careful what you say, because I'm listening to. I don't mean to be eavesdropping, but you know, this is all fodder for us. How about you tell us a bit about Bottlebrush Creek, a bit about the story for readers, and show us your lovely cover.
Yes, so this is Bottlebrush Creek. We've got Angie McIntyre, who's a lovely lady on the front cover, and I love this front cover. She is a very bubbly, very vivacious, the youngest of the McIntyre sisters. So I have four different sisters that pop up through my books, and each book is centred around a different sister and a different story of, you know, where they're at in their life. And so I focused on Angie. She's got a young daughter called Claudia, and her husband or her partner, Rob, is fly in, fly out. And I thought, well, what can I give her? What's she going to want? Well, she wants to bring her family closer together. And The project they settle on that might be the key to doing this is a little rundown cottage with 200 acres. They've got enough room. They can run some cattle. They can have some sheep. They can have chickens and perhaps a couple of crops. So enough land to do something with. And they want to renovate this cottage. But it's not until after Angie's done the tour through the cottage, she's fallen in love with the pressed tin on the ceilings, the beautiful foot-high skirting boards, the weatherboard that all need to be ripped off and replaced. But she finds out pretty quickly, and it's not too much of a spoiler to say so, that it's right next door to her in-laws. So Rob's farm that he grew up on is right next door, which is a little bit of a stumbling block for them because they haven't had too much to do with his side of the family. And we find out as the story goes on, you know, there's a few issues there. So I focus on the renovation side of the project, of course, the relationship between Rob and Angie. Rosa, who's the mother-in-law that lives next door, she gets a really good run in this story, and she's a very lovable character and an amalgamation of all the different enthusiastic grandmas that I've ever known. So depending on whether you're Rosa's age or whether you're Angie's age might have a bit to do with which character you sympathise with and whose side you might take throughout some of the conflicts. But it was a lot of fun to write. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, and I can see that, you know, you feel that through it as you're reading because you feel that warmth coming through there. And, you know, that's important to a reader, I think. If they feel that you've connected with it yourself as a writer, it's just so much more relatable to them. And I think there's also a lot that people can relate to in this. You've got this young couple who are madly in love. They've got their dreams and the whole moving, and then wham, like one challenge after another. It's not the renovation, as you say. It's the biggest one would be, you know, knowing that your mother-in-law is living right next door. Depending on your relationship with them, I have a beautiful relationship with my mother-in-law, so I don't actually think I'd mind. But, you know, but who knows? I'm not in that situation. But I think you just throw these situations at them that take them out of that kind of, you know, dreamy, like we're going to have this beautiful cottage and live happily ever after, to realising their relationship's really getting tested and in multiple ways. So what are some of these challenges? Do you want to share a few of them with us?
Yeah, so one of the things that I wanted to look at was, I guess, the dealing with tradesmen and how they react with a woman on site. Because, you know, as you would know, Monique, there's so many work sites, like building sites, that women aren't, you know, the norm on them. So we've come a long way, but I think there's still a lot, there's a lot of preconceived ideas on who's going to be giving directions and orders and paying for things or making final decisions. So I wanted to explore that. I wanted to talk about some of the different joys of country living. So the farming aspect and raising your own animals, talking about the potential pitfalls, you know, snakes are a bit of a feature, and feral animals as well. They don't always, you know, they're not always kind to people that live on a rural property. Then we've also got, I think one of the things I also wanted to explore was a relationship with Rob and his twin brother, Max. So we don't hear much about Max. Angie doesn't know much about her brother-in-law, but we kind of go into a bit more detail about that. And that did spark from a conversation that my husband was telling me about that he'd had with another person, talking about their twin and how they are very close. You know, they maybe saw each other once a year. And that one line sparked this whole train of thought in my head. Well, what is the definition of close? You know, your close might be very different to my close. And twins, you kind of expect that they're going to be close. And what happens when they're not?
That's right.
I'm a lot of fun with that.
Yeah, I can see, you know, that whole dilemma of coming there and then having the brother suddenly, you know, appear, and then what's this going to bring? And so it just takes the story in yet another direction. One of the other things I felt when I was reading was that the pressure on Rob and Angie's relationship, because they realise very quickly that they don't know each other that well at all. They've got a child between them and they know that they love each other. But then this whole move really, really tests their relationship. Is that something? Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yes, I have friends and family members whose husbands fly in, fly out. And just the stories that they would tell me about, you know, that adjustment period when the partner would come back home, it'd take, you know, a week to get used to having him in that family dynamic again, and then, you know, it would move off again, and they had to readjust to, you know, not having him there and be completely independent and resourceful, you know, running their own ship in his absence. So I want to talk a little bit about that. Like, the whole story, Rob's not fly in, fly out. He finishes that job up pretty early, but they do realize that, you know, the pregnancy that was a bit of a surprise early on in their relationship is just one of those things that kind of fast tracked it. And, you know, they're not necessarily, as you said, as close as you might think they are, and they think they are. So I like a bit of fun with all the different gaps in their relationship and how they navigated that. And then I also loved throwing in, you know, things that I love, like baking and dahlias. And talking about some of the other pitfalls of small communities, which is you'll get roped into community volunteerism pretty easily. So I've just kind of run with as they've come to me and had a great time with it.
Yeah. I was going to ask you about the community side of things, because I did feel that this book did dive into that, but in quite an amusing way with your characters, with the Dahlia Society and things like that. And of course, the character with his goats, you know, he was just so funny, you know. And that's something I think it's probably one of my favourite aspects of the rural fiction genre, is meeting all the characters on the sidelines who, if you actually look when you go to country towns, they're really there, you know, these people. But how do you belong? If you're somebody who's grown up in the suburbs, let's say like myself, and you know, I've had a lot of exposure to country life, but I haven't lived in a really small town. So how would you get involved in that community or feel like you belong?
Yeah, I think, Monique, that is a bit of an age-old dilemma, and there's a lot of small towns where you have that feeling that unless you were born there and your parents were born there, then you're not a local. And some people will stoutly deny that. And I've been to a community meeting not far from where I live, where someone said that exact thing, and another lady who had lived in the town, you know, many years, and her parents had too, she, you know, stood up and said, well, that's not true. We certainly accept people. But I can see it from both sides of the perspective because, you know, my parents were migrants. So my dad came from New Zealand. My mum came from England. The small town that I grew up in, you know, they lived there for almost 30 years. But I think it took a while for them to be considered local. And I think the mums groups and the school involvement, they're probably the key things for getting involved, which then, of course, makes it tricky. If you don't have young children, then you're kind of almost like a fish at sea when you do arrive in a new town without those touch points and regular, you know, like the play groups and the music lessons. So I did have a lot of fun kind of exploring that. And we've moved quite a few times from small town to small town with my husband's work. And it isn't always easy to make new friends unless you do dive into those volunteer groups like the Young Professionals Network and then the Kindergarten Committee, and all the different things like that. If you're not inclined that way, it makes it quite tricky, I think.
Yeah, I think that's exactly it. There are people who wouldn't be inclined. You know, they're shy or they just don't like to be among the bigger groups and things like that. And I've moved around a lot as well because I've lived in, you know, Sydney, that's where I grew up, and Canberra and Albury Wodonga, and then back to Sydney and then across to Perth, and lived in a few places in Perth. And each time brings its own challenges because you start again each time, and depending on that stage of life you're in will dictate, you know, what you get involved in. And sometimes it can be good, you know, it's really, you make friends quite quickly, and then other times suddenly you're having to grow, you know, dahlias for somebody that you didn't really want to. But you do like growing them. So where did that love come from?
So my mum has a green thumb, and she's always puttering around the garden, and every time I go home, it's not complete without a tour around the garden to see what roses she's got to bloom and what seedlings she's just put in. So I've kind of grown up with my parents loving growing things. And then when we moved to the property, I think 2013, we bought the property that we're on at the moment, and it was just a bit. So So I was taking donations from anyone who wanted to give me a cutting from their garden and say, yep, no worries. So I put in, you know, these huge yakkers that now are so big that poke your eye out. So we had to rip them out. Agapanthus that, again, we had to, you know, use the tractor to pull them out because they grow so well down here. And one of the things that was handed over to me was from mum was a set of dahlias. Now, I'd never known my mum to grow dahlias. She wasn't into pretty flowers when I was younger. She was more, let's get the veggies going so that we can feed the kids. Anyway, she gave me my first set of dahlias that had been gifted to her by a chap called Mr. Ellis. And it's funny because the lady in Bottlebrush Creek who gives the dahlias is called Mrs. Ellis. So that's a nice little throwback that you can kind of do with different scenarios. It's just adding a name that means something to you and maybe it'll make someone smile as well. So I love the dahlias. I've got a huge patch. I've got a couple of big patches and I'm already excited about next year's flowering season. It's I think it's a bit of an addiction.
Yeah. I think I've been looking at your photos and thinking I wouldn't mind growing some of those in my little patch that I've got in the backyard. Most of ours is turning to natives now because it's just easier for us with rainfall and things like that. But your dahlias have certainly inspired me. I might be doing pictures of those next year. You never know. So
excellent.
The character Rosa, I found her to be a really lovely character. I can see why she would rub Angie the wrong way because, you know, Angie's a young woman who's a young mum. She wants to be independent and to make a go of this herself, and she sees that Rosa, with all her constant baking, which Angie really misses doing, you know, she sees that as that bit of an interference and doesn't quite know how to, I suppose, set boundaries and things like that. Did you find yourself relating, like you mentioned earlier about sympathising with the characters a little bit. Who did you sympathise more with?
I have to say Angie, seeing she is my main character. And I was aware, though, that, you know, the two different characters would appeal to the different demographics. And it was quite interesting because in my mind it was pretty cut and dried. How Angie was reacting was very reasonable. You know, when you've got young children, you don't really appreciate people, you know, knocking on your door at all hours, and well-intended offers of help don't always go down as well if they're constant or if they're, you know, contrary to what you've asked to happen. So I could also see, though, from Rosa's perspective, because, you know, I know some lovely ladies who are grandmothers and they talked to me about their different, you know, I was trying to help out doing this or trying to help out doing that and it didn't go down well. So I could see both of their perspectives, but I had a lot of fun, you know, writing that conflict. And you have to rein yourself in so it's not a cliched conflict either. It has to be, you know, genuine and understandable and reasonable. And I think that's when, you know, a publisher like my fabulous publisher Annette at Allen Unwin comes in handy. She can, you know, take that step back and say, okay, well, what about this and this and this? And is it because of this that Angie's feeling that way? And they have this way of looking at your work and knowing where you're trying to go. And you go, yes, I didn't realize that's what I was doing, but that's definitely what I was doing. So it's really great to have that teamwork.
That objectivity is so important, isn't it? Because I think you become so close to what you're writing that you just can't see it. You can't see if you're being stereotypical or, you know, you're missing some layer of depth in the character or something like that. But these publishers can come along or editors and say, what if you try this? And you go, oh, yeah, that's the missing ingredient. That's the little thing. So you're writing now a third book, so based on which sister was it, Lara next?
Yes, we've got Lara coming in.
Yep, and then Diana. So that would be book four. Out of the four sisters, do you find that you relate to one more than the other, or are you kind of sprinkled in to all of them?
Yeah, I'm definitely sprinkled into all of them, Monique. And I think that's a great question because I've found that I've had more of a preference for whichever one I'm working on at the time will be my favourite, and because I'll be so immersed in their story and why they're doing things the way that they're doing and the different pickles they get into. You know, you really feel for them. And I talked to my husband about Lara and Toby, the two main characters in next year's book, you know, as if they're real people. people. So I'll say, now, yeah, this, what would you do? Or, you know, what do you think Toby could say in this situation? So I'm constantly bouncing ideas off him, but talking as if it's a completely realistic situation.
Yeah. I'm so glad I'm not the only one. Because I feel like lately I've just been talking about my characters. We were in a town called Bridgetown, which is near to, it's about 2 hours from where we live. And it's the setting really for my book. And I keep saying, like, oh, that's the shop that Amy would have gone to, or that's the place that Matt, you know, blah, blah, blah. And I swear, I think I'm driving him crazy.
It's
I'm glad I'm not alone.
No, I feel it shows a connection to your characters. And, you know, I can tell that your new book, which for anyone who's not aware is called Where Have You Go? And it's out September. I think that really shines through in people's writing when they've got that connection to their characters and their story.
Yeah, I think it is. It's just something that you, I suppose, when you've worked on something and it means a lot to you, it's inevitable that it will come through. What's your publishing journey been like? It looks like on the surface, it looks like it was fairly fairly easy. You decided you wanted to become, you know, to write fiction, and then by, you know, 2 years later, you were reaching out to publishers and you had a contract with Allen and Unwin. Was it really as easy as that little summary?
Well, Monique, long story short, I think it's been a very smooth journey for me. And I feel very fortunate that I was picked up by Australia's, you know, a fantastic publisher. And to have your work championed by someone from a publishing house is just the best feeling ever. So, look, I think I've been very fortunate. And I think having that background in journalism, doing a course on writing my first draft through Writer's Studio, that also was a huge help because, you know, I decided that if I wanted to go down this path of trying to write a book, I didn't want to spend 10 years thinking about how I'd do it. I researched it and went about it quite methodically. So I think that worked in my favour. And also joining the Romance Writers of Australia was a really good step because all of a sudden I was surrounded by people who love writing. There were that I could enter my manuscript in and get feedback in before I decided to inflict it on any publishing houses or agents. So it's been a really good run, and I'm very grateful to have two books out and one on the way.
Yeah, that's right. Well, I'm just glad that you're writing and that we can read what you're writing. You're very talented, and I think you bring that warmth that people are really needing at the moment. So that's a good thing. With, I guess, I was thinking about, I'm actually thinking about scones because I'm looking at them now and I'm starting to get hungry and I heard my stomach grumble. What I'm actually thinking is with the rural romance genre, why do people love it so much? Oh, yes, you've got your scones ready. Good.
Yeah, a bit of homemade quince jam. I think people love rural romance because, you know, it's got those country elements, so people know they're going to have, you know, some type of farming element in there. And I think because more people are living in the city these days, there's a lot more nostalgia for rural fiction. I also think that love makes the world go round, and when you're having a tough time, when you need an escape, when things aren't going so well in your own world, it's really lovely to pick up a book and know that it's going to have a happy ending. Now, it's not spoiling the book by saying it has a happy ending because it wouldn't be a romance if it didn't have a happily for now or ever after. But I've had some beautiful letters from people. A lady in particular from Queensland sent me a message to say, I picked up your books while I was doing chemo for breast cancer, and it was just the best escape. I was, you know, feeling very, very lonely, very vulnerable, very down about my body. And then I picked up your book and I could escape into those characters and have a smile on my face and feel that warm glow. So it's really, it gives me tingles to be able to offer that to people. It's a really, really nice book.
That's really lovely feedback. I'm so glad that you've had that feedback and people, you know, take the time to tell you that. But I'm also glad that what you've written has made people feel that way and just given them that little bit of, I guess, that hope when in that situation things aren't feeling so good, and you've just made someone feel really, really good for that moment they're reading, which is really good. Yeah. So I think it's time for scones. What do you reckon?
Yes, I've been looking at those since about an hour ago when we started getting organised. The children got to sample some this morning, so they were pretty happy with it. It means that a recipe from Catherine Hine. Now, she's an author that I did a event with earlier this month. And we recorded this fantastic event for the Australian Romance Readers Association. Mm-hmm. And all about the different scones that we made, how we make them. And I've been slowly but surely trying the different recipes for the ladies who are on my panel. And it's been a win.
Oh, this sounds really, really good. I might need to get some of these recipes. I went with a lemonade scone recipe. Because it's a real winner. It's really, and they stay soft for a lot longer than the regular sort of scones seem to. So I made mine last night when I got home from work, and then said my husband and I could have afternoon tea together this afternoon. So he's looking forward to that. But I have got homemade apricot jam on mine with apricots from my tree in my suburban backyard.
That's a win.
Yes, definitely a win. And I shook up the cream as I was sort of preparing for this interview. I was sitting there with a little cup of cream in my hand like this so it would get thicker. But look, Maya, it's been wonderful talking with you today and just finding out more about yourself and about, you know, your writing, about your book, and really just, I think, people should go and buy it if they're looking for that escape and they're looking for that time to just read something that doesn't ask too much, but a few hours and a cup of tea and maybe a scone. So, thank you for chatting with me.
It's been lovely to chat to you, and thanks to Kualini Arts Centre as well for hosting Stories on Stage. What a great initiative.
Yeah, it's been a wonderful last probably 3 months now. It's been really good to be able to do this. And yeah, look, a lovely interview to end on, I think. So.
Lovely. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
Thank you for joining us for Stories on Stage online edition for the last 3 months. We really have had a terrific time chatting with many different Australian authors who've had new releases and haven't been able to launch them in the ways that they wanted to, with their book tours and going to libraries and things like that. So this has been something we wanted to do to help our authors and just give them that little bit of promotion and chance to talk about the creations they've worked so hard on. And we're hoping to return to normal Stories on Stage programming sometime soon. But in the meantime, thank you very much for joining us all the time. We really appreciate it. Bye.